Well, thank you everyone for inviting me to talk at this Maxonette Spring School. So indeed, this talk is not going to be that technical, but it's going to try to illustrate the things that are extra requirements between what you're learning when you are at the PhD level. You're learning lots of algorithms, techniques, and so on. But then when you want to make those algorithms work in practice or in an industrial environment or for a product and you want to sell them to people, there is a couple of extra things that you need to do to make that happen. So hopefully this talk will illustrate some of that. So yeah, I'll just tell you a bit about of background about audio analytic, what we do, who we are, and so on. We are going to have a look at machine learning and classifiers because that's what we use for sound recognition. We're going to look at data collection, training and testing, error analysis, experimental design, which are kind of stages of what you're doing when you're doing a sound recognition product. So, audio analytic. The company is essentially commercializing automatic environmental sound recognition. So for the smart home. So we do the recognition of every sound which is not speech or not music. We do every other sound than that. And this is also known as audio event detection. At the moment, we have a number of flagship sounds that we recognize. So we have baby cries, smoke alarms, and glass breaks, which are really the top of the demand in terms of applications in the smart home. And then we have also aggression detection, detection of aggressive voices, detection of car alarms, gunshots, and keywords. And we sell that to four applications in the smart home. So you have a whole new class of IoT, so Internet of Things objects, connected objects in the smart home. And for example, we have a customer called Swan. They make surveillance cameras for the smart home. You buy a box of cameras, you install them yourself, and it's DIY security, essentially. And from last year, now the Swan cameras have an extra line on the user manual which says this camera can recognize your baby crying or your smoke alarm or if someone is trying to break one of your windows. And that's our technology running in the Swan product. So essentially, we're a B2B company. We sell to other businesses who are going to incorporate our software in their product. And we're targeting mostly the smart home market. So in terms of the topic itself of sound recognition of non-speech and non-music sound, it's a fairly young research topic. And it's actually a very different problem from speech recognition and from music recognition. Insofar as the acoustic space is very, very rich, you have beeps, you have paralinguistic speech, so people shouting, coughing, laughing, and so on. You have crashes and knocks, which are part of the audio environment. And you also have broadband noises, aircon, vacuum cleaners, that kind of thing. So it's not as bounded to harmonic sounds as speech is or music is. There is no notion of language model. So in a speech recognition system, half of the work is being done by the language model. You train a language model on your Wall Street Journal, and that constrains what words, that constrains the recognition of the acoustics themselves. So you don't have that at the moment in the domain of sound recognition, although you could think of acoustic scene as having some kind of implicit grammar. If you have a room full of people listening, you're going to have a certain type of sounds. If you're going to have a room with people having dinner, for example, it's going to be another type of sounds, and so on. But so far, no one has built a model of that kind of sound co-occurrence in acoustic scenes, as far as I know. One thing also which differs from speech and music is that you have a quasi-infinite prior and false positives. So your system gets continuously exposed to a variety of the sounds that you don't want to recognize. In most speech applications, you have either a trigger word to start the sound recognition, or you have a trigger button. In your car, sometimes you have a speech button. Or in the music, you're sending a particular snippet of music to your fingerprinting application. In the case of sound recognition, you need to have a system which listens all the time and which is able to reject an infinity of the sounds that are going to be thrown at it, which are not the target sound. So that's quite an interesting problem in itself. Also, the recognition of environmental sound has to be working with far-field audio capture. So whereas speech recognition, sometimes you are speaking in your phone or so on, now you have more and more applications of speech with a far field capture. The Amazon Echo, for example, is capturing across a room. For the environmental sound recognition, you have to be doing far field recognition. Another problem which is linked to the channel, to whatever captures the audio, is channel effects. And so I'm going to talk a bit more about channel effects later on. But you have to deal with a multiplicity of channels and different devices. Most of them in the smart home market are consumer electronics, so they not the audio circuits are not necessarily optimized for good quality, and you have to deal with that because most customers don't want or don't have the budget to change their design. So you have to work with the existing channels, even if those channels are distorted and so on. Right, so how do we solve the recognition of environmental sounds? We are using machine learning, so we're using algorithms able to learn and recognize patterns from data. You're probably all familiar with machine learning. But that's as opposed to expert system. We're not having a system where we're trying to describe exhaustively what's going to happen in the audio. We just record databases and have a system which learns from that. So let's talk a bit about machine learning. Machine learning, I put the image power to the data because, again, machine learning to a large extent is driven by the availability of data. And machine learning is gets the modeling of what you're trying to model from the data, not from a great deal of human knowledge that you put in the system. Now, I'm going to say a couple of things which are an extremely simple way of describing machine learning. Machine learning, most machine learning algorithms implement classifiers. Classifying things is essentially matching an observation to a label. You're looking at that big gray thing, you say, okay, it's big, it's gray, it's got a thing, it's a mammoth. Okay, that's the simple description of what machine learning does. It's giving labels to observations. So digging into that, if you take a simple experiment of classification of two types of animals, the mammoths and the frogs, for example, mammoths are big and gray and frogs are small and green. Therefore, if you have something big and gray, then your machine learning system is going to infer it's a mammoth. If it's small and green, then it's a frog. Notions which are behind that, which are notions which are going to help in the rest of the talk, are you have a notion of a label, so it's a frog or it's a mammoth. In the case of sounds, it's going to be you want to say this is a baby cry, this is a smoke alarm, this is a glass break, and so on. Then you have notion of features. So in this simple example, it's the size and the color. In the case of the sounds, that's going to be mostly descriptors of what's in the spectrum of your sound. So spectral components, so the spectral envelope, for example, or spectral flatness, or description of the energy. Is it loud? Is it not loud? Description of the harmonic structure. Is there any harmonicity? Is there any harmonic structure in your signal? And so on. It's a whole set of descriptors that you can imagine, which are the features of your sound. And then your observations. So in that case, you get them from in that example, from a zoological survey. In the case of sounds, you get them from sound recording. So important notions are you have a feature space. So in that simple example, that would be an axis which gives the hue, for example, and another one which gives the size. You have your data points in that feature space. So in that case, frogs are small and green, and the mammoths are big and gray. And those things are labeled mammoth or frog, and then your classifier is essentially drawing a line between those things to decide which one is which. Now, obviously, things are not always that simple. If it was an image recognition task, you might have a big gray frog and a small green mammoth. So essentially, in your feature space, things might be a bit mixed up. So the first thing to consider is that choosing or designing the right feature set is important, and is as important as choosing the right classifier or the right machine learning algorithm. The classifier, the machine learning algorithm, is going to draw the boundary between your data points, but your data points may or may not be separable depending on the features that you're choosing to describe your data points or your sounds or your objects that you're trying to separate. So this is really important. Machine learning exists in conjunction with features and descriptors of the things you're trying to classify. So to give you an example of diversity of sounds, so these are spectrograms of various types of sounds. So spectrograms, I suppose all of you are familiar with a spectrogram. You have the time and you have frequency. Whenever you have something dark, means you have energy in that frequency band. So if you have a sound which is a smoke alarm, for example, you have information across the time axis, okay? You have a sequence, and then you have a very concentrated information. You have one single tone which gets repeated with a particular time pattern. Then if you take a baby, for example. So baby is a bit more complex. You have some harmonic structure in the baby cry. You also have some vocal fry. It's obviously not as simple as the smoke alarm in terms of the features of the audio. This is a glass break. So glass break has a sharp attack followed by some tones when the glass falls and makes those little tingles. And the tingles themselves are happening at random frequencies. You don't have like a stable tone like you have in the smoke alarm, for example. And this is a... This is a vacuum cleaner. So it's got that kind of broadband noisy white noise spectrum, but then it also has that very interesting whistling noise in the middle. So again, it's a mix of something which has some tonal information and some noisy information. So the system has to deal with all of these things, and your feature set has to be dealing with that. You don't need to have the same feature set for all sounds. You can adapt your feature set depending on the sound. But your feature set has to be able to capture what is really salient about the target sound that you're trying to recognize. In terms of algorithms, there is a wide choice of machine learning algorithms. You have linear discriminant functions, decision trees, Gaussian mixture models, deep neural networks. They all have different properties, support vector machines, and so on. I'm not going to talk too much about that. There is lots and lots of textbooks about this. One good textbook is Pattern Classification by Duda Hartstock, although it might be a bit outdated now. But there is plenty of books about machine learning, so I'm not going to focus particularly on machine learning. But what's to know about the machine learning is that different algorithms are going to draw different types of separation geometry in the feature space. So if you take a decision tree, it's only going to be able to draw boxes, straight lines between your data points. If you take a GMM, it's going to draw parabolic separation between your data points. If you take a support vector machine, it's going to draw the margin between your positive and negative examples. And if you take a neural network, it's going to be able to make more complex manifolds, so more complex surfaces to separate your data points, essentially. Now, the thing is, you never actually see the data because it's going to be multidimensional. If you take, for example, the Kepstrom parameters, which are a description of the spectrum envelope, it can be 13, 14, 15 dimensions. So as humans, we can't actually see what's happening in the data. But what you can do instead is to examine some measure of goodness of the model, so classification rates, typically. So the idea here is that evaluation is crucial in order to choose the right model for the right task, because you don't see the data, because you don't know a priori how the geometry of your data looks like. What you do is you try different models and then you pick the one which is going to give you the best classification rates. Now, sometimes I like to be a bit provocative in saying that. So these are the steps in what you're doing when you're doing machine learning. You do data collection and labeling, you do training, then you do your testing and evaluation to know if your model is delivering the proper classification of what you want to classify. And then you do some qualitative assessment, which is also known as error analysis. Now, the provocation is the red things are what you learn at school, the green things are what actually matter in practice. So, what I mean is the following. So, let's talk a bit about data collection. So data collection needs to cover the variability of what you're trying to recognize. So what it seeks to do is to sample all plausible variations of the same labels. So in that case, I'm following up with the example of elephants and mammoths and so on. You can have all that kind of variation in elephants, just like you can have many different types of variations in the different sounds that you're trying to recognize. So in terms of glass break, for example, you can have windows with different sizes. The pieces of glass are going to have a different dimension, so the tingles are going to sound different. In terms of smoke alarms, for example, different smoke alarms have different tones, have different time patterns, you need to cover all that in your data collection. So there is a proportion of intrinsic variations, different frequencies, tone patterns, and so on. But there is also variations due to external factors. You have the room response, which has a big impact on the sound itself, especially for percussive sounds. And then you have the microphone response as well, which is known as channel effects. Actually, the whole audio path that's going to be from the air to the microphone to the DSP, to the audio card, digital to analog converter, to everything. Each of these building blocks is going to have a little influence on the sound. Sometimes you have devices with self-noise and so on. So you're trying to cover all that when you do the data collection. And when you do it for a product, it can be quite a larger space than when you're just trying to do it for an experiment to compare two different algorithms. But you have to be really strict with that, because you really want to cover whatever is going to happen in your product, in the end, in your sound recognition product. So to give you an example of channel effects, this is the same sound captured by 9 different consumer electronics camera. So the two last ones had self-noise. One of them had the white noise. The other one had a tone, which was just there because of the electronics, because of the design of this camera. Then you have all sorts of different equalization curves. One of them was sounding more in the low frequencies, like boosting the low frequencies. The other one was completely cutting off the low frequencies. And so that's a real example. That's things we have recorded with an array of different consumer electronics camera, and that's the reality of what you have to deal with when you're doing a sound recognition product. So in terms of data collection itself, so that's when we did the data collection of the glass break. We bought about 180, I think it was 180 windows with different sizes. We hired a hangar, which was in a old military base, and that hangar is where they used to do, at Alconbury, where they used to do the testing of aircraft engine noise, and the whole hangar was padded with non-reflective material. So it was like a humongous anechoic chamber, and we essentially spent a whole week breaking windows and recording them. There we go. This is when we did the smoke alarm data collection. So we bought every single available model of smoke alarm available in the UK and available in the US. And one funny thing about that is that some of the smoke alarms have an electronic component which has a small dose of radioactive material to ionize the air and measure the smoke or something. Actually finding a way to ship radioactive material from the US has been quite a bit of fun as well. But there we go. Now we have probably one of the biggest databases in the world of smoke alarms recorded in various locations and so on to capture the whole variability of the smoke alarm sound and to make sure that we really were as exhaustive as possible in covering those smoke alarms. Now, once you have your audio recordings of the data, you need to do what's called... Yes?
But why in practice do we need to detect that in some room there is a sound of smoke alarm? Because in practice this sound, the detection should be transmitted by the line to some monitor, for example?
Not necessarily. Most people have a smoke alarm that they bought at Tesco in a supermarket, for example. It's not particularly connected to anything. Smoke alarms which are connected, for example, the Nest smoke alarm costs something like $150 or something, which is extremely expensive. Most people just are not going to change their smoke alarm. So essentially, the goal is when you're not at home, if your smoke alarm goes off, our system is able to send you an alert to first detect that the sound is being produced when you're not here to hear it. And then you can get an alert when you're not at home. So essentially, your home is listening to itself when you're not here to hear it.
Okay.
Yeah? Okay. So once you have the data, you need to do the labeling because you need to tell your machine learning system where are the target sounds and where is everything else. So in that kind of example, that was a simple speech signal. But in order for your machine learning to know where is the speech and where is the silence, for example, you have to label that. So essentially, you're telling which sound is where in the timeline to your machine learning system. And that's labor intensive and very costly. That's actually one of the costly parts of the exercise, and that should not be neglected. Labeling is one of the things that's going to hit you when you do a product. But it must be done, otherwise the machine has no reference of what is a baby cry versus what is a glass break or what is silence or what is whatever else. So it has to be done. And it has to be done well. Because if you have errors in your labeling, that's going to pollute your models. So essentially, if you were telling your early scientist that this big gray thing is a frog, that's what the system is going to learn. We had an interesting anecdote. Like a few years ago, we had a glass detection system which was going on going off on bird songs. And we're like, how is that possible? It's a completely different structure. And we just discovered that the place where we had done those early recordings, that was really like 3 years ago, was a house which was where there was building works being done, and some of the windows were off, and you could get birds from outside in the garden, and because the labeling was catching one of the glass breaks when at the same time where the birds were singing, that actually stained the model. So you really have to be careful with the labeling, because that's again a critical thing in your system to have a proper labeling of your data. So you have to do it essentially. Now there are ways to do that automatically or semi-automatically. You could use semi-supervised or unsupervised approaches, but you would still need some level of human checking or hand correction. If you do supervised, essentially if you do your labels by hand, you tell your system these are the circles, these are the crosses. If you do it in an unsupervised way, your system would be able to find clusters. I mean, assuming the data is separable and assuming the model is catching that kind of property of the data, it would be able to draw clusters, but still the machine doesn't know what's a circle and what's a cross, so you would still need to manually tell it, this is the cross, this is the circle, or this is sound X, this is sound Y. Now you can do another thing which is semi-supervised, which is you label a proportion of your data, and then you let the system label the rest of the data. But again, you have to be careful because that can go in certain cases awfully wrong, and the only way to find that your data is that your labels are off is to actually have a look at the data and to get them manually checked. So this is really, really important for the quality of your sound detection system. Now, training and testing. So machine learning software, you can find implementations now in open source implementations, free implementations that you can just download and use. Scikit-learn is in Python is pretty good. You have Weka, which is a package from the University of Waikato, which is a bit outdated now, but still has lots of very interesting stuff in it. Theano is one of the standards for deep neural networks. So you can find these things. They're not a big barrier to entry into machine learning market. You don't have to program your whole training system yourself unless you want to do a new method of training. But even that, you can start from existing packages and then modify them if you want to put new stuff in them. But now the thing is, you have to know how to use these systems. You have to understand the models that you are manipulating, to understand their parameters, to understand what's important to set in the parameters of your algorithm.
Can I ask,
sure.
With using such software as a company,
yeah.
Are
Not necessarily. It depends on the software. Fortunately, lots of academic partners, academic actors understanding that one way to create pathways to impacts is to make the software usable by companies as well. And actually, that's a way. Software is also a way to talk to people. So no, it depends on the licenses. But most of these licenses let you do whatever you want with the software, which is really good news. But again, if you had a question about the software, then you would go and see the academic partner who programmed the software. So it's an interesting way of creating bridges between academia and industry is around software. And obviously, free software is going to attract more attention than paying software. Now, most companies will use training software out of the box, but the decoder, which is the part which actually does the sound recognition once the model is trained, that's going to be proprietary. And that's going to need to be, I'm going to come back to this, but that's going to need to be the part of the system which is performing sound recognition as it should. Training itself, there is not a lot of value in the training unless you have some better ID and there is value in the know-how. Okay, you have to know how to use your software, but the software itself, reprogramming the EM algorithm for the zillionth time is, or the backpropagation for that matter and so on. So all these models have lots of parameters that you need to tune, and that's part of being a good machine learning cook is to know what ingredients you need to mix and to what proportions and so on. So for example, in the case of deep neural networks, you have to choose your number of layers. In the case of GMMs, you have to choose the number of Gaussian clusters. As I said before, you need to choose your feature set, so you might want to do a bit of optimization of your feature set. For neural networks, you have notions of learning rates and so on. For any gradient descent algorithm, you have learning rates and so on. So essentially, there is quite a lot of knobs that you have to set to the right value. And again, that's part of the job, and that's part of what's going to make your system a good system, is to perform well with that optimization. And so setting all these meta parameters is an optimization problem. And again, in order to optimize things properly, you need to have evaluation metrics which are really reflecting what you want to optimize. I'm going to come back to the evaluation metrics later on, but you have to make sure that you really optimize what is representative of the performance of your system. Training itself, so in terms of infrastructure, different types of algorithms may require different types of computer infrastructures, computer facilities. GMMs and SVMs, you can get away with just a multi-core PC to achieve tractable training times. But when it comes to deep neural networks, you must have a GPU, a graphical processing unit. If you want to have, one of the things which really kicked up the performance of deep neural networks and made them tractable was access to GPUs, was the CUDA language from NVIDIA and so on. Having proper type of computer to implement neural networks was really part of success of neural networks themselves, part of the revival of neural networks. So there we go. So if you want to do neural nets, you need GPUs. Otherwise, multi-core PCs are okay. In any case, parallelization helps. So even if you're just focusing on GMMs or SVMs, if you want to optimize your model parameters, make experiments with different number of clusters or different feature sets and so on, the more parallelization you can get, the faster you can get with your training and with your tuning of your system, essentially. In terms of how you evaluate the system, so in order to understand how you evaluate it and what drives the metrics that drive the optimization, you have to understand the types of errors that a sound classification system makes. So the way sound classification work is most of these models, GMMs, AVM neural networks, are going to be able to deliver some kind of similarity score between your input, your observations in your feature space, and what the model has captured from the data. So if you look at this graph, imagine you have, for example, this I think is a smoke alarm sound. And so in the silence, your score is, imagine it's a distance. So your distance is high, the distance between what you observe and your model is high. And when you come into the smoke alarm, then distance reduces. And then once you go out of your smoke alarm, the distance increases again. If it was a likelihood, that would be the other way around. You would have maximum likelihood within the alarm and then minimum likelihood outside of the alarm. But we represent it that way to have a notion of similarity between the sound and the model. Now, the way you perform classification is sooner or later, you have to have a threshold somewhere which tells you where you trigger a detection and where you don't. So that green line here, I don't know if it's possible to see it with this projector, but anyway, there is a green line here which separates your score within the label from the score outside of the label. Now, if you look at the density of your scores across your whole testing database, you're going to have a bit of overlap between the target scores and the non-target scores, but still you have to put your threshold somewhere. So the notion here is the notion of operation point. And I'm going to explain that in more detail, but essentially depending on where you place your threshold, you have a different compromise between false alarms and misdetections, which are the two types of error that your system can make. So talking about sound detection errors, couple of definitions. Target sound is the sound you want to detect, in this example, baby cry. Non-target sound is is every other sound that the one you want to detect. So you don't want your system, if it's a baby cry recognition system, you don't want to trigger on voices, on vacuum cleaner, on shower, TV, whatever. Now, the type of sound sensing errors are the other way around. If you don't detect the baby when your baby is crying, it's a misdetection. Another sound that the baby, so for example, TV in the example, is triggering a baby cry alert, this is a false positive. So a non-target sound which triggered an event. Now, given those two types of errors, they are linked, you can make your system more or less conservative. And that's a user choice, essentially. So if you want to make your system more conservative, you're going to put your threshold more down if you consider the distance, this score being interpreted as a distance. If you put your score more down, you're going to have less false positives, but you're also going to have more misdetections because your system lets through less of the sounds, essentially. Conversely, you could make your system more permissive. So if you set your threshold more higher up, then you would not miss any of the true positives, but you would have a bit more false alarms appearing in your alerts. So those two types of errors are linked, and the link between them is called the operation point. Now, one thing is when you compare machine learning algorithms, you don't want to compare the wisdom of the choice of the threshold. What you want to compare is the power of your system to capture the characteristic, the nature of the sounds. So instead of using one classification rate after setting the threshold, we use something called the detection error trade-off curve, which I'm going to show you in the next slide, which plots all possible trade-offs between false alarms and misdetection rates by essentially browsing the thresholds on your score. And then the detection error trade-off curve can be summarized in one figure, which is called the equal error rate, which locates the dead curve along the diagonal. So these are examples of dead curves. So on the x-axis, sorry, you have the false alarm probability as a percentage. In the y-axis, you have the misdetection probability. This is on a logarithmic scale. It's not actually a logarithmic scale. It's a Gaussian normalized scale. Because this is a kind of warped version of the ROC curves. I don't know if you've heard about rock curves, but essentially this is information is the same as in a rock curve, but in a way that's more readable because that kind of makes the line a bit straight.
What is the difference between rock curve? I mean,
This is a warped rock curve, essentially. It's a normal deviate correction of the rock curve. So it makes it a lot more readable, because the rock curve, if it was not normalized, you have rock curves which get squashed in the corner here, and then you can't really, once you have two systems which are fairly similar, it becomes difficult to see the difference between your systems.
Okay, so what did you do? I mean, you apply inverse normal inverse transform to scores?
Yes, you apply the, yes. There is a fantastic article from Przyboski, Doddington, and which dates back from a few years ago. They were using this in speaker recognition for the NIST evaluation, and everything is described fantastically well in this article. If you want, I can give you the reference at the end of this. I can even send you a piece of code that does this kind of normalization. It's essentially public stuff. So your dead curve. So essentially, in that example, you see that at, say, 30% false alarm probability, you would have something like 1-ish% of misdetections. So that would be an example where the system is very permissive, because you have lots of false alarms and only few misdetections. The other way around, if you want to reduce the number of false alarms, you could set your threshold at an operation point more like here, where you would have 2% of false alarms, and but then at this stage, you would have quite a lot of misdetections. Now, the equal error rate is simply the coordinate of your dead curve along the x equal y axis. So it's a convenient way to summarize the dead curves, to summarize the position of the dead curves under the assumption that they're kind of fairly diagonal. So in that case, yes, the dead curves are fairly diagonal. In that case, we see that, for example, the neural networks on this particular task, that's an experiment which dates back, quite a few months. We're going to publish that soon in an article with Mark. Essentially, that's a secret experiment, don't say. But anyway, in that particular experiment, the neural networks performed best, because across the whole range of thresholds, they were doing a better compromise than the other models, which were support vector machines and Gaussian mixture models. Now, dead curves are not always nicely diagonal like this. So in that other system, we had dead curves which were a bit more kind of straight. And so for these kind of dead curves, for example, you could have a very, very nice compromise between the misdetection and false alarms. For example, at 0.5% of misdetection, you would have only 2% false alarms. So not all systems have such a drastic kind of balancing relationship between misdetection and false alarms. Sometimes they're nicely shaped, like this one, where we can have a good minimization of both types of errors at the same time. Now, error analysis is also important, because the dead curves and the equal error rates give you a rate. They give you a percentage of classification across your test set with true positives and false positives, I mean target sounds and non-target sounds, but they don't tell you what the errors are. So if we take an example, for example, where we assume that a test database is recorded across 100 homes, this is a toy example, yeah? And that it's got a false alarm rate of 20% on baby cry detection. If it happens that, and in that toy example, it happens to be that Muffy the dog, hence the picture, happens to be generating 90% of all false alarms and from one single home. That means that your remaining 99% of homes share 2% of the false alarms. And if you ignored or if you solved that single problem of that dog triggering the baby cry, then the false alarm rate would fall to 2%. So the message here is really that rates don't tell you what kind of errors are being produced, and it's important to understand the nature of errors being produced to be able to correct and improve the system. In that kind of example, if there is only one problem, yes, it's got 20% false alarms, which doesn't seem very good, but if it's only one problem, is that a good system or is that a bad system? That's a bit of a dilemma. So sometimes solving one single problem is going to get rid of a humongous amount of your errors. So following up in that line of ID, so the dead curves and equal errors are giving you a rate. but they don't tell you what specifically needs to be addressed to make the system better. So in that case, if we address the dog versus babies, we would solve a huge amount of the false alarms. Also, one thing is beware of horses. So that picture is a picture of a horse called Clever Hans. And I stole this example from a researcher called Bob Sturm, who is doing work in that kind of area. And that everyone believed that this horse was able to do mathematics. And so people were asking the horse how much is 2 plus 3, and the horse was tapping his hoof 5 times, and people go, oh my God, he can do additions. But actually what the horse was doing was not addition, it was picking on the people's reactions, because people were getting excited the closer he was getting from the result. The horse could actually perceive when the result, from people's reaction, when the result was going to be good. So the horse was not actually doing mathematics, it was doing detection of behavior. And that's something that can happen in a machine learning system. So part of the work of Bob Sturm was in the music detection area, where he proved that some systems which were thought to do gender classification, music genre, were actually classifying the tempo of the music. So if you were shifting the tempo of the music, that would obviously not change the genre, or not that much, but then the genre classification rates would completely fall from the fact of changing the tempo. So so that's one pitfall which is really, really important to avoid in any classification system. In case of sound classification, for example, you have to make sure that what your system captures is the target sound and not, for example, the channel, the microphone, or something else that is also present in your data. So that's really important to examine that in your data. What is it that the system is actually doing? And do you have a qualitative proof that the system is actually capturing what you wanted to capture? In the case of babies and dogs and so on, that would be harmonic sounds. Is there something else than harmonic sounds that can distinguish between both temporal structure or whatever? There is also a notion of errors which may be, from the standpoint of user experience, which may be acceptable, in the sense that it's just the dog. Don't you think it sounds like a baby? I mean, some dogs whine like babies. So to which extent do you want to push the discrimination of sounds? And sometimes people themselves will not be able to tell the difference between a target sound and a non-target sound if the characteristics are that close. So some of the errors are arguably errors. But again, it depends how strict you want to be with your classification. Now, for example, a dog being confused with a baby, if the dog is whining like a baby, is a more forgivable error than if a vacuum cleaner, for example, is triggering a baby cry for sound. Because from a perception point of view, people will really not be happy if, will not understand to begin with, that a vacuum cleaner would trigger a baby cry for sound. So there is a notion of quality of errors, and that's more on the user experience side of what we're doing at Audio Analytics. So to go around these things, we apply a bit of experimental design. So detection is traditionally evaluated over closed data sets. So you use precision recall F-score in traditional academic studies. Now the problem with those measurements is that they're okay to compare systems given a data set, but those measurements depend on the size of the data set. Because in these equations, TP, FP, and so on, are an absolute number of true positive or false positives. So if you change your data set, if you, for example, have here a larger square, if you were blowing up the area of that thing, that would change the value of your precision recall and F-score. So those measurements are not directly interpretable when you want to measure a real-life system. Now, one thing is, in the practical reality, the real sound detection system will be continually exposed to non-target sounds. So the right side area will be completely like blown up to infinity. And in that kind of case, your measures of precision in that case become invalid. So another thing linked to the fact that we are dealing with time signals and with the continuous recognition of time signals is that true positive units are still fairly easy to define. A baby cry is what's between your baby cry labels, or a smoke alarm, or the beeps in your temporal sequence. You can locate that in time. But it's more difficult to define what the false positive units are. Are you going to take a fixed time unit as your false positive unit, or what? So the way to go around that for a commercially deployed system is the true positive rate is still valid. Okay, out of 100 baby cries, your system detects, I don't know, 95, for example, out of the air. But then the false positive rates have to be expressed per time unit. So what customers want to hear is, I'm not going to get more than one false alarm per month. And actually, the constraints on that are people actually don't want to be disturbed by the system. So usually it's the guideline or the target is you don't want to have any false alarm for a whole quarter, for example, three months. So the message here is that errors translate into user experience. And that's something that you don't necessarily learn at school, to come back to the provocative slide. You need to evaluate end-to-end user experience, not just the machine learning error rates when you are trying to do something, when you are trying to sell that kind of system and to develop it for commercial applications. So how do we evaluate user experience and all these things I just talked about? So we have designed a thing called the prototype of listening object, the Polo. So this is not a product, this is not the thing we're selling, but this is the thing we use to evaluate our product being a software library. So this prototype is an end-to-end testing platform. It's used to test our product, which is called AI3 for Audio Analytic Acoustic Intelligence, which is our sound recognition product. The hardware is based on a Raspberry Pi and off-the-shelf components, so things you can buy off-the-shelf from Amazon and various electronics companies and so on. And the user interface is made of Python because that was the quickest way of coming up with a user interface and quick prototyping of this thing. But again, this is not a product, this is just a testing platform. Product itself is an embedded C code, fixed point, super small, super fast, real-time audio decoder library. It's programmed in C. So you can, because it's C, you can interface it with anything. You can make hooks to C++, Java, C#, VB.NET, Python, everything. The code size is 50 kilobytes. It's very, very small. Memory occupancy, 50 kilobytes as well for three typical software sensors. It runs on ARM, x86, IA64. It works on everything. We don't use any external system libraries. Everything is programmed. All the math is programmed by hand in fixed point. It's OS independent. We've run it on Windows, Linux, RTOS, Android, you name it. Things which do or don't have an OS. Essentially, we've run it on bare metal kind of microcontrollers, which only run a real-time OS, essentially, which is not a full-fledged OS. It works with 16 bits per sample PCM, 16 kilohertz audio. We found that 16 kilohertz is good enough to cover most of the sounds that are of interest for commercial applications. 8 kilohertz is not enough because you would lose some of the smoke alarms, you would lose some of the glass break characteristics, but 16 kilohertz is good enough and is available in most consumer electronic products. And then the typical computational cost of sound recognition in our library, on an ARM9E processor, it's going to take 10 MIPS to process the 16 kilohertz. Sounds at a sampling rate of 16 kilohertz. At some point, we were doing variable sampling rate, but now we're defaulting to 16 kilohertz. On an Intel processor, it's also going to take 10 MIPS. And then every time you add another sound, you're going to have two more MIPS to your MIPS budget. Sure. Yes.
Can you program it to say, I don't have a baby, so I don't care about detecting baby?
What do you mean?
Suppose I can configure it to not detect some event?
Yeah, yeah, yes, of course. So you have a base decoder library, which is the AI3, and then you have what we call sound sensors, which are sort of plugins, which are the data piece that you plug into your decoder to specialize it to various kind of sounds. So you can either specialize to one particular sound, or you can detect several sounds at the same time. It's up to you. Part of the way we sell the software, we give people a choice. Do you want one sensor, or do you want several, or do you know what are you interested in for your product? Do you need it for, if you want to make an intelligent baby cry detector, then you're going to buy only baby cry. If you want to make a whole smart home package, then you're going to want probably the top three, which are baby cry, glass break, and smoke alarm, and so on. It's configurable, essentially. Yeah. Yes?
In case of overlap of two sounds.
Yeah. Yes, so it is able to detect both. Yeah. So obviously it depends on the capabilities of your machine learning algorithms. Okay, it's essentially a kind of noise robustness problem, because if you have a smoke alarm and a baby cry, if you consider the smoke alarm detector, the baby cry is going to be an interference. If you consider a baby cry, the smoke alarm is going to be an interference. So it depends on the capability of your algorithm of ignoring certain types of interferences. In the case of baby cry and smoke alarm, you would still be able to detect both accurately. So functionality of this testing platform. So coming back to the Polo this time. So the Polo is running the AI3, the software library which implements the decoder in that very efficient way. Then it's got a microphone. It's able to listen to the sounds around and then perform the detection of the sounds. When it detects the sound, it's able to package the sound into an email and send it to your mobile phone or to your email account. So whatever you use to read your emails, you can use to retrieve the sound and listen to the alert which triggered the detection. So supplying this audio clip of what has been detected is nice for people to check what's actually going on when a detection happens. So this type of device enables real field testing of our technology, essentially. And so with that, we can access actual true positives and false alarm rates in the field across a sample of representative homes. So there again, you're going to want to apply some experimental design. You're going to want to have a quota of you want a family because children are going to make a certain type of sounds. You want old people because maybe they're going to be more quiet, but maybe their TV is going to be louder. You want to have someone with Murphy the dog. You want to have a guitar player because you want to have a guitar player. You might happen to have people with construction building happening close to their home. You might happen to have people with a certain type of environmental, of consistent environmental sound. If they have their home close to an airport, you're going to have aircraft noise coming and so on. So you really want to sample all of that as much as possible to check the robustness of your system and to tackle the real problems that those things are actually triggering. If you have a sample of homes like this, that also gives you access to user experience measurements. So you can start asking people about opinion scores. So you can ask them if they are happy about this and that aspect of the system. You can ask them if they understand sound recognition, if they understand what the system is actually doing. You can ask them if they found the system desirable, accessible, is it easy to use, credible. Do they believe that the system does what it does? Valuable, so is it useful for them to get baby cry alerts when they're not there, and so on. Findable is not as applicable to sound recognition, but there we go. And then usable, is it easy to use in the way they want to use it? And this again is part of the reality of things.
What is the output of your Polo system? It indicates an alarm.
Yeah.
Does it say what the alarm is, or does it play the audio?
Yes, it says what the alarm is. So you're going, for example, typically to get a message which says a baby cry detection has been triggered. And in the email, you're going to have a link to an audio clip which captures your baby cry with, 10 seconds length around your baby cry, essentially. So you can listen to what triggered the alarm. It doesn't give you the user opinion, but user opinion we do with a survey during or at the end of the experiment.
Do you adaptively learn?
I can't tell, but it would, let's say it this way, it would be stupid not to use the data.
Speech recognition, you know, one of the big things was
yes,
that people started doing.
Correct. So now the thing is, the availability of labeling by users depends on other parts of the system design. In order for people to say yes, I agree, this is a baby cry or not, you need a button somewhere that people can push. Some customers are willing to work on that with us. Some customers are not willing to work on that with us because adding a button would cost X, Y, Z in terms of engineering to do this and that. So again, that boils down to the labeling. If the labeling is doable, then we would be stupid not to use the data. But then it's not that simple. Now, with that kind of volume of data, when you have a deployment, if a customer sells a device across millions of homes, then you start having a volume of data which might allow to do some unsupervised learning. So we have some interesting things that we can do in that kind of domain. Absolutely, yeah. So ideas to take home from this talk. So that was about machine learning applied to sound recognition. You have algorithms are important. You have to choose the right algorithm, but you also have to choose the right acoustic features to capture the sound of interest and work in both domains, machine learning and so acoustic features that would be more on the signal processing side of things. Both are important for the success of your end application. Data collection and labeling are critical success factors, and they are very costly. Data collection aims at capturing the variability of your sounds of interest and at covering the channel effects as well to make sure that your system works generally across all consumer electronic systems. Evaluation is also a critical success factor. Nobody wants a horse. You really want to make sure that what you evaluate is really what's going to tell you that your system does what it's meant to do, so recognize the actual baby cries and stuff, and not recognizing a channel distortion or a beep in your signal or the birds in your data. And one thing which is making this in real world a bit different from published papers about sound recognition is that the non-target sounds are an open set. Your system is listening 24/7. In a variety of homes where you can have all sorts of people, all sorts of sounds, all sorts of activities. And it's important to keep that in mind when you're doing a product, a real-life application. Now, in the commercial domain, end-to-end user experience matters. So machine learning is only one piece of the system. Of course, you want to minimize your false positives and misdetection rates. But in the end, what you really want to optimize is customer satisfaction, usability of your system. You really want to make something useful. You don't want to make something which is just 2% X and 0% Y. That has to translate into something that people are going to use, understand, and appreciate. That's it. Thank you for your attention. Thank you very much.
So you said that data collection and classification was very important.
Mm-hmm.
Have you thought of doing data collection, just harvesting data, say, from movies or glass breaking?
Movies are not real sounds. If you take a gunshot for a movie, chances are it's going to be a sound effect. And most sound effects are what people think the thing should sound like and not necessarily what it sounds like.
Glass
breaking is much louder than you think. Or what movie producers think. If you were playing a real glass break in a movie theater, half of the people will run out of the room because that would break there.
Concerning classification, have you used some crowdsourcing thing?
The labeling, you mean? Yes, we are working on that. For the moment, we have outsourced to specialized companies a proportion of our labeling. We're doing a proportion. We're organizing our own pools of laborers as well. It's a mix of things, whatever works, depending on the size and the nature of the data. We are working on the as well with crowdsourcing platforms. The problem with crowdsourcing platform is the detection of cheats. So you have people who just go click to get. So there are some research issues. It's not something you can do out of the box without a minimum of caution of how you use it and how you control the quality of your labeling. So it's a mix of things. We've had cases depending on the data sets where either we've done them ourselves with Cambridge. We're based in Cambridge, so there's lots of students who want a job and stuff. So you can do that, or you outsource. But it may or may not yield good quality results, or you use crowdsourcing platform, but then you really need some way of controlling the quality. Yeah, sorry.
Yes. I just wanted to clarify. So one measure of quality is whether you detect correctly. Another is you need to consider. So you have the periods of time when there is no sounds, and how then you cut these periods into pieces. I mean, to calculate false alarms.
So it's a false alarm per time period.
Yes.
So if we have, for example, weeks and weeks of recordings across homes, okay. Across that, you can count the number of false alarms, because whenever you have a false alarm, you get your message with your clip. You can label that as in is it an actual target sound or is it not? And that gives you a rate per period of time, so depending on the sound. And that's the kind of thing you want to minimize, because people really don't like false alarms. So typically, you want to achieve rates which are no more than one false alarm per month or something like that.
Okay, but your classifier, in fact, which you apply, it provides one label per time frame.
No, it produces events across time. It's continuously on, and then sometimes it goes off. If you have a baby cry, it's going to go off on the baby cry.
So you have a kind of sliding window.
Yes. It's constantly listening. Yes, a sliding window, if you wish. Yes, correct.
Okay, but then for each moment of time, you can put the label whether it's 0 or 1.
Yes, except that some of the events have a variable duration. So, for example, a smoke alarm, you know that the beeps are going to be half a second long with a half a second in between or something like that. So you could consider your unit to be half a second, but then you start having difficulty synchronizing with your timeline. So, yes, for your false alarm rate, you could slice your time in finite time units, but then it brings other problems of synchronization and so on. So really, in practical application, the best way to get a rate is the false alarm per time unit. If you slice your timeline to have, discrete non-target units that generates other problems of synchronization, you have to choose what your unit duration is. And that poses synchronization problem when you have a real baby. You're not sure that this is going to start at the very beginning of a baby cry when you have a true positive. So best way is really the false positive per unit of time. Yeah.
Okay, so I think if there are any more questions, yeah. Then yeah. Let's handle them in the...
Maybe just one more? Yeah. There was
just one more,
yeah.
Does your training set include noise data also?
Yes. Yes, during data collection. Some of the data is harvested, some of the data is purposefully recorded. So we've done recordings of babies with the background music, for example, with lullabies and that kind of thing. We've done recordings of places where the environmental sound around people living close to a road, for example, with the windows open. Some data is harvested, some data we directed the data collection towards noisy data and things we knew were going to be problem in the product. So,
and
will
the training set then have the data with noisy data and the...
Yes.
Data?
Yeah, correct.
Okay, so thanks. Let's thank Sacha again and all the speakers today. Thank you very much.